Welcome to Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading.
Today, we are going to discuss the Hindu newspaper dated 25th November 2018 of the New Delhi edition. The news to be discussed has been presented on the screen and timestamping for the same has been provided in the description box below. Now let's start our today's discussion. Now this news appears on page number 1. It reads, Odisha now has a lexicon for rare tribal languages. It says that this move is seen as a push to preserve vanishing native languages in the state with largest tribal diversity. So, with respect to conservation of largest tribal diversity in the state of Odisha, this news becomes very important. In your prelims examination, this topic forms a part of your social geography. In your mains examination, this topic forms a part of GS paper 2, specifically with respect to welfare schemes for vulnerable sections, as well as GS paper 1 on salient features of Indian society, including the tribal communities of India. So in this news, it mentions that in order to prevent vanishing of tribal languages of Orissa, the government of Orissa has come out with tribal dictionaries of 21 such languages. Now this lexicon comprises of a bilingual tribal dictionary, which will be used in multilingual education, that is MLE. And this MLE, that is multilingual education, has been initiated by the state of government at the elementary level in tribal dominated districts. Further, this bilingual tribal dictionary has been composed by Special Development Council created by the state of Odisha and also helped by the Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe Research and Training Institute. Now these dictionaries will help in improving proficiency in the tribal languages, which will further help in communicating in a better way with this tribal population of the region. Further, the tribal museum in the state of Odisha has been upgraded as Odisha State Tribal Museum. So all these steps have been taken by the state government of Odisha for better communication with the tribal community of the region. So far you must be thinking that whether all these steps taken by the state government of Odisha is really necessary. So in this aspect, you must remember that Odisha has a unique place on the tribal map of India, as it has the maximum number of ST communities in the state. Further, these tribes speaks 21 languages and also has 74 different dialects. Another important fact is that of the 21 tribal languages, 7 have their own scripts. So considering all these tribal diversity in the state of Orissa, it is important not only to conserve these various tribal languages, but also ensure measures to promote these languages and also help the government functionaries in understanding these local languages so as to better communicate with these people for their social and economic development. Thus, this step taken by the state government of Orissa to constitute a bilingual dictionary becomes extremely important with respect to the socio-economic development of these tribal communities. Now, despite the diversity with respect to languages and dialects in the state of Orissa, Odia has been mainly used as the medium of communication in the dictionaries. Further, adoption of more widely spoken languages such as Hindi, English, Odia, and even some of the dominant tribal languages of the region has led to the disappearance of these rare dialects. Thus, preparation of this bilingual tribal dictionary will help in preserving these rare regional dialects. Further, it will also help in promoting these diverse language dialects as well as scripts. Further, it will also help in ensuring awareness with respect to these diverse languages as well as dialects among the local population of the state. Also, it will help the government functionaries in better communication with respect to either government policies or any steps related to the development of these tribal communities. And it will also benefit the students as well as researchers who are researching on these rare languages or dialects spoken among the tribal population of the state. Hence, these can be said to be the benefits of this bilingual tribal dictionary prepared by the state government of Odisha. And also this dictionary as a medium of communication will further bring the government functionaries closer to the tribal community. As you can see, as per the government notification of state of Odisha, it provided for establishment of special development councils in tribal dominated districts of Odisha. It mentions that tribals should be extensively involved at all stages of the development process, starting from identification of deficit areas, felt needs, plan formulation, implementation, as well as monitoring. so that the development of these tribal communities becomes more effective, inclusive, as well as participative. And in this aspect, the government provided for the creation of special development council for each tribal dominated districts of the state of Odisha. It further says that these councils specially focus on preservation of tribal culture, traditions, heritage, as well as unique identity of each tribe. So in this aspect, this creation of special development council in the state of Odisha becomes extremely important, as it is important for the preservation of the tribal culture as well as traditions. Now the special development council has been constituted in 9 tribal dominated districts in the state of Odisha, namely Mayurbhanj, Kyonjhar, Sundargarh, Kandhamal, Gajapati, Koraput, Raigarh, Malkangiri, as well as Nabarangpur. Now I'm telling you about all these districts so that if you read anything related with respect to tribal development, then you should know, and it's also related with the Special Development Council created by the state government of Odisha. Now the functions of these Special Development Councils include conservation of tribal culture aligned with development objectives, propagation of tribal culture for retaining tribal identity, recognition of the indigenous knowledge system of the tribals, as well as its promotion to help support retention of tribal culture, documentation of tangible and intangible tribal culture, tradition, as well as practices, identification of tribal resources, and also making the indigenous knowledge as well as unique culture as a means of livelihood. So both these documentation and making these culture as a resource for means of livelihood becomes extremely significant for their conservation as well as socio-economic development. Further, it helps in promotion of tribal languages and dialects for developmental communication. Also, optimum utilization of available resources in tribal areas, which further results in sustainable development of these tribal communities. Further, culture-specific or area-specific developmental interventions, which helps in addressing the needs of these tribal communities. So these are basically the main functions with respect to which these special development councils have been created in 9 different districts in the state of Odisha. Further, we mentioned about the Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes Research and Training Institute. This institute is devoted to research and training on tribal matters, their cultures, as well as their development. Further, this institute has been conferred the status of Nodal Tribal Research Institute by Ministry of Tribal Affairs, Government of India. Thus, this aspect becomes important from your prelims examination. The activities of the institute involves research, planning, evaluation, training programs, statistical computation and analysis, publication of various reports, and also collection, documentation and display of museum objects, as well as preparation and publication of museum booklets, and also with respect to technical guidance and supervision of cultural program on the auspices of annual Adivasi exhibitions. So these are some of the activities in which this particular institute participate. So the objective of this SC&ST Research and Training Institute includes carrying out research studies for documentation of distinguishing characteristic features of different scheduled tribes as well as scheduled caste communities of the state. Further, to study the process of social, cultural and economic change and also development among these ST and SC communities of the state. Also to prepare action plans and suggest effective measures to take up various development initiatives for these scheduled tribes and scheduled castes, and also to serve as a center for providing data and advisory services to the government on issues relating to problem as well as development of the ST and SC communities of the state. So in this aspect, these objectives become extremely important. Now further, you must also know about the particularly vulnerable tribal groups in the state of Odisha. So these are the 13 particularly vulnerable tribal groups in the state of Odisha. Now this topic of particularly vulnerable tribal groups have been already covered in comprehensive detail on DNS dated 21st November 2018. So to understand more about particularly vulnerable tribal groups, you can refer to this DNS video of 21st November 2018. Where we mentioned that Ministry of Home Affairs categorizes these tribal groups as PVTGs, that is particularly vulnerable tribal groups, and Ministry of Tribal Affairs implement the scheme of development of these PVTGs. Further, we also mentioned the criteria for determination of these PVTGs, which are a pre-agriculture level of technology, a stagnant or declining population, extremely low literacy as well as subsistence level of economy. So in this aspect, to understand more about these particularly vulnerable tribal groups, you can always refer to this DNS video dated 21st November 2018. So now this question forms your first practice question on the functions of Special Development Council. Now what you can do is to pause this video for 5 seconds and then we will discuss the answer to this question. So the question was asking, State Government of Orissa has constituted Special Development Council for Tribal Dominated District of Orissa. Which of the following can be said to be the functions of this SDC in Orissa? First, conservation and propagation of tribal culture. Second, recognition of indigenous knowledge systems of the tribals. Third, promotion and preservation of tribal languages and dialects. Now coming back to our discussion, you can see the functions included conservation of tribal culture, propagation of tribal culture for retaining tribal identity, recognition of the indigenous knowledge system of the tribals, and also its promotion to help support retention of these tribal culture, as well as promotion of tribal languages and dialects for developmental communication. So we find that all these three statements becomes correct with respect to the functions of Special Development Council created in the tribal dominated district of Orissa. So in this, D becomes our correct answer. So we understand that this particular news on bilingual tribal dictionary in order to prevent vanishing of tribal languages of Orissa becomes extremely important to understand from our examination point of view. With this, let's move on to the next news. The next news appears on page number 13. The news reads, Prayers in Snowland. The stunning vistas inside and from Ladakh's Hemis Monastery. So in this particular news, let us learn certain basic facts with respect to Ladakh's Hemis Monastery as well as about Ladakh itself. In your prelims examination, it forms a part of history and culture as well as Indian geography. Now this article particularly mentions about the Hemis Monastery in Ladakh, the annual Hemis Festival which takes place in Ladakh, as well as the rich heritage of Ladakh as well as its surrounding monasteries. As you can see in the map, the location of Ladakh in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So about this Hemis Monastery, it says that this monastery belongs to the Drukpa side of Mahayana Buddhism. So this point becomes important from your prelims perspective. Next, it says that Hemis is probably among the richest monasteries in the region, which was built in the 11th century and was then re-established by King Senge Namgyal around 1590 to 1620 AD in the 17th century. It further mentions that this monastery is divided into two parts. There is an assembly hall known as Dukhang and a temple called Shokhang. So another important point to remember about this Hemis Monastery is that it is divided into two parts. One is assembly hall, which is referred as Dukhang, and the second is the temple, which is referred as Shokhang. Here you can see the word Gompa, and Gompa is the local word for monastery in Ladakh. So as mentioned, the annual Hemis Festival is celebrated on Guru Padma Sambhav's birth anniversary in the monastery. This festival showcases masked dancers and it takes place on the 9th and 10th days of the 5th month of Tibetan calendar. And these days usually falls in the months of June or July. So this annual Hemis Festival takes place in the month of June or July. Further, it says there is a hermitage known as Godsang Gompa, built by Swalya Godsangpa, which predates this monastery, that is, whose existence can be traced prior to the Hemis Monastery. Now let's learn something more about Ladakh from class 7th book of NCERT from chapter 10 from the book Our Environment. So it mentions about the cold desert in Ladakh, where it says Ladakh is made up of two words, La meaning mountain pass and Dak meaning country. So a country having a mountain pass as per the meaning of the word. It says that Ladakh is a cold desert lying in the Great Himalayas on the eastern side of Jammu and Kashmir. It further mentions that Karakoram range lies in the north of Ladakh and Zaskar mountains lies in the south of it. So you can see that Karakoram lies in the north of Ladakh and Zaskar lies in the south of Ladakh. It further says that several rivers flow through Ladakh and Indus being the most important river among them. The rivers form deep valleys and gorges and several glaciers are found in Ladakh. For example, the Gangri Glacier. It then mentions about the altitude of Ladakh, which varies from 3000 meter to 8000 meter in the Karakoram Mountains. And it says due to its high altitude, the climate is extremely cold and dry. The air at this altitude is so thin that heat of the sun can be felt intensely. Now this becomes a critical information with respect to climate of Ladakh. Now as you can see in this map, Shyok River as well as Indus River flow around the Ladakh range. It further mentions that Ladakh is also known as Khapchan, which means snowland, and this was also referred in the newspaper. Coming to the flora and fauna, it says due to high aridity, the vegetation is sparse or very less. There are scanty patches of grasses and shrubs for animals to graze. During summers, fruit trees such as apples, apricots and walnuts bloom. It further mentions about various species of birds which are found in Ladakh, such as robins, redstarts, Tibetan snowcock, raven as well as hoopoe are common among them. And some of these birds are migratory birds. The animals of Ladakh are wild goats, wild sheep, yak and special kind of dogs. And these animals are reared to provide for milk, meat and hides, that is skin. It further talks about the people living in the area of Ladakh. It says that the people are either Muslims or Buddhist. And we can find various Buddhist monasteries around Ladakh. Some of the famous monasteries include Hemis, which we just mentioned, Thiksi, She and Lama Yuru. It further mentions that Leh, the capital of Ladakh, is well connected both by road and air. The national highway number 1A connects Leh to Kashmir Valley through the Zojila Pass. Now this again becomes a important information. With respect to passes, it says that Leh Highway crosses 4 passes, namely Rohtangla, Bara Lachala, Lunga Lachala and Tanglangla. So this again becomes important aspect with respect to our prelims examination. So all these informations about Ladakh becomes important and can be asked in your upcoming prelims examination. So in this aspect, this news about Hemis Monastery becomes important to understand about the monastery as well as to know about certain basic facts with respect to Ladakh. Now these two forms your practice question for the day. What you can do is to take a pause for 5 seconds and then we'll discuss about both these questions. Now coming to this question, it says, consider the following statements. Hemis Monastery belongs to Drukpa sect of Hinayana Buddhism. No, this statement is incorrect as it belongs to the Mahayana sect of Buddhism, which we have already discussed. Second, Hemis Monastery is divided into an assembly hall and a temple. Yes, this is correct. Third, Hemis Festival is celebrated annually in Ladakh. Yes, we have already seen this. Since 2 and 3 are the correct statements, so here D becomes the correct answer. Now coming to this question based on Leh and Ladakh, it says, which of the statements about Leh and Ladakh are correct? First, Ladakh is the capital of Leh. No, that statement is incorrect as Leh is the capital of Ladakh and not Ladakh being the capital of Leh. So this statement becomes incorrect. Second, it has cold and arid vegetation. Yes, this is correct as Ladakh is a cold desert. Third, rivers Indus and Shyok flows through Ladakh. Yes, this statement is also correct as we have already seen that in a map. Fourth, Ladakh is enclosed by Karakoram range in the south and Zaskar range in the north. We have already discussed this, that Zaskar range lies in the south and Karakoram range lies in the north of Ladakh. Hence, this statement also becomes incorrect. So, 2 and 3 is the correct statement. So, in this, B becomes our correct answer. So, in this news, we learned basics about Hemis Monastery and certain basic facts with respect to Ladakh. With this, let's move on to the next news. The next news appears on page number 14. The news reads, multiple reasons behind premature births in India. Harassment is also an associated factor. Now, this news talks about premature birth and it says that maternal mortality as well as child mortality are one of the major reasons with respect to preterm or premature birth. Further, this news also highlights about a report of Indian Human Development Survey. So in this news analysis, we'll try to understand all these aspects with respect to Indian Human Development Survey and multiple reasons behind premature births in India. For your mains, this topic gets covered under GS paper 2. In this aspect, it's important to understand about premature birth. So as per World Health Organization, premature or preterm birth is defined as babies born alive before 37 weeks of pregnancy being completed. So such babies born alive before 37 weeks of pregnancy is termed as premature birth. So in this analysis, let's try and find out the key findings of this human development survey. Now this survey analyzed nearly 8,000 women in India who gave birth between 2004 and 2005 and between 2011 and 2012. Now this report has pointed out that there is a strong association between adverse birth outcomes and sanitation access, gender-based harassment, as well as physical labor. So this report highlights that these aspects has an implication with respect to adverse birth outcomes or premature birth. Now as per the report, 49% of these 8,000 women suffer from preterm birth, whereas 15.5% of these women suffer from low infant birth weight. So birth weight here means weight of a child when he or she is born. Now if the birth weight is less than 2500 grams, then it is diagnosed as low birth weight. And when the birth weight is diagnosed as less than 1500 grams, then it is termed as very low birth weight. Thus, this term birth weight becomes extremely important with respect to health of a newborn baby. Now, other reasons for preterm birth and low infant birth weight, as highlighted by the report, is fetching water, where the researchers have found that spending more than 2 hours per day with respect to fetching water is also associated with low birth weight. Further research highlights that sharing washrooms and even open defecation leads to both preterm birth as well as low infant birth weight. Further, harassment of women is also associated with both premature birth as well as low infant birth weight. Now, some of the major reasons as highlighted by the report for premature birth are multiple pregnancies, infections and chronic conditions, specifically with respect to diabetes as well as high blood pressure, inadequate water and sanitation access, physical stress from fetching water, as fetching water includes standing for many hours per day. Further, the report highlights that lack of access to private toilet forces this woman to cope up with their various basic and biological needs such as urination, defecation, as well as menstruation. Women are forced for these personal needs into the public areas, which further adds to their physical as well as mental stress. Thus, poor community level social conditions as well as inadequate personal hygiene due to poor infrastructure increases the risk of adverse birth outcomes. Thus, some of the basic concerns is that most of the homes in low-income countries do not have private toilet facilities as well as private drinking water sources. Thus, lack of drinking water as well as private toilet facilities increases the risk of both, that is, preterm birth as well as low infant birth weight. It further mentions that India tops the list of 10 nations which contributes 60% of world's premature deliveries. So it's quite understood that India, in most of the region, still there is a lack of drinking water facility as well as private toilet facilities. It further mentions that lack of awareness and suboptimal use of technology will further enhance preterm birth as well as low infant birth rate. Thus, the article suggests that for a possible solution, there is a need for intervention to reduce domestic responsibilities, basically with respect to water as well as sanitation facilities. Further, there is also a need for a change social norms specifically related to gender-based harassment, as both these can help in reducing preterm birth as well as low infant birth weight. Further, there is a need for reduction of stress, anxiety as well as depression among women so as to reduce both preterm birth as well as low infant birth weight. Thus, it is in this direction that India needs to build upon the infrastructure facilities to improve neonatal survival outcomes. Further, India also needs to strengthen the tertiary care services at medical colleges by creating special care neonatal units at district level as well as subdivision level or at sub-district level through the health facilities. Further, there is a need to think on new models such as public-private partnership which can facilitate sharing of load on public institutions, as these private institutions can help the public institutions, specifically in the health sector. So all these suggestions becomes important with respect to improving the conditions, which will further reduce both preterm birth as well as low infant birth weight. Thus, in this news analysis, we understood about the key findings of Indian Human Development Survey, the major reasons for premature birth, as well as possible solution to reduce preterm birth as well as low infant birth rate. So in this aspect, this article becomes extremely important and relevant with respect to our UPSC examination. With this, let's move on to the next news. The next news appeared in section 2 of the Hindu newspaper on page number 4 as well as 5. Now this news is about Amur falcons. It says, rustle in the skies. Amur falcons from Siberia form clouds above Pangti, a village in Nagaland, as they descend for a 2-month roost before flying off to warmer climes in Africa. Now, your prelims examination, this forms a part of biodiversity as well as environment. Now, this news particularly mentions about the migratory routes of Amur falcons as well as the Doyong water reservoir, where these Amur falcons takes a rest on their migratory route. As you can see in this map, these Amur falcons travel from the cold climates of China, Mongolia, and even Siberia towards the warmer climates of Africa, and in between they stop in Nagaland around the Doyong Dam Reservoir. Now this Doyong Dam Reservoir is formed due to this Doyong River, which flows in the region. Now this Doyong Reservoir, which is surrounded by hills, hosts the single largest congregation of these Amur falcons, as at this spot these Amur falcons takes a break before continuing its journey across the Indian Ocean towards warmer climates in Africa. The falcons are protected under the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, and this becomes a critical information with respect to your UPSC prelims examination. Now, state of Nagaland hosted the first Amur Falcon Conservation Week from 8th to 10th November 2018. So this becomes another key information with respect to our prelims examination. The IUCN status for Amur falcon is least concern. And as mentioned, these Amur falcons are protected under Schedule 4 of Wildlife Protection Act 1972. So all these basic information with respect to Amur falcons, including its migratory route, becomes extremely important for us to understand from our prelims perspective. Now this forms your fourth practice question. What you can do to take a pause for 5 seconds. It reads, Doyong Dam Reservoir is often seen in news regarding Amur falcons. It is situated in, options are Manipur, Nagaland, Assam and Tripura. As mentioned, this Doyong Reservoir, which is a congregation of Amur falcons, is situated in the state of Nagaland. So in this, B becomes a correct answer. So in this analysis, we learned about the migratory route of Amur falcon as well as about Doyong Dam, which is in the state of Nagaland. With this, let's move on to the next news. The next news appears page number 9. The news reads, water flow in Ganga woefully inadequate, and center looks abroad for ideas with respect to ensuring flow in the river Ganga. Now this topic in your prelims examination forms a part of general issues on environmental ecology, as well as in your mains examination, it forms a part of GS paper 3 under environment. Now this news mentions that according to a recent notification of the Government of India, the minimum flow of the river Ganga has been inadequate. The reason provided is that dams and barrages in the entire Ganga river basin are restricting its flow. So as per the government, these dams and barrages are restricting the flow of river Ganga. And as per the experts, the biggest threat to the survival of river Ganga is its declining flow. So we understand that reduction of flow in the river Ganga has become a major concern. And in this aspect, there is an alarming fact which mentions that the discharge from Gangotri Glacier has also shown a declining trend from the year 2000 to 2016. So all these information reflects that the flow of river Ganga is quite inadequate. Now in this aspect, the central government is in talks with various experts from different countries such as Germany, Laos, Austria, as well as Egypt. And these discussions are to evolve a Ganga River Basin Management Plan. In these discussions, the Government of India discussed the various experiences of these countries in managing their rivers such as Danube, Rhine, Mekong, all of which flow through multiple countries. So it is in this aspect that the Government of India is trying to understand that how these countries manages the flow of these river, which is very important for river Ganga. Further in this aspect, there is also a draft Ganga law in the making, which is meant to ensure the health of the river, that is to ensure that the flow of the river continues. The news further mentions that this draft of the Ganga River Basin Management Plan analyzes the river in terms of environmental quality and pollution, water resources management, fluvial geomorphology, ecology and biodiversity, socio-economic and socio-cultural aspects, policy, law and governance, as well as geospatial database management. So these were the different aspects in which the river Ganga were analyzed. So far in our discussions, we have gone through two important terms. One, Ganga River Basin Management Plan and National Mission for Clean Ganga. So let's understand these two important words with respect to this news analysis. As you can see that National Mission for Clean Ganga is a registered society under Ministry of Water Resources, River Development and Ganga Regeneration. And this becomes an important aspect with respect to your prelims examination. Now this Ganga River Basin Management Plan is a comprehensive river basin management plan being prepared by a consortium of 7 Institute of Technologies, that is IIT Kanpur, Delhi, Madras, Bombay, Kharagpur, Guwahati and Roorkee. The objective of Ganga River Basin Management Plan is to ensure comprehensive measures to be taken with respect to restoration of the Ganga ecosystem and also improvement of the ecological health of the river. Thus, the vision and mission of Ganga River Basin Management Plan can be summed up as disaster protection and recovery, environmental knowledge building and sensitization with respect to Ganga restoration, sustainable agriculture, ecological restoration, Aviral Dhara, Nirmal Dhara and geological safeguarding. And the vision in this aspect include ecological entity, geologic entity, Aviral Dhara and Nirmal Dhara. So this is with respect to vision and mission of Ganga River Basin Management Plan. Now another term mentioned was National Mission for Clean Ganga. Now this National Mission for Clean Ganga acted as the implementation arm of the National Ganga River Basin Authority. And this National Ganga River Basin Authority was constituted under Environment Protection Act 1986. However, the National Ganga River Basin Authority as of now has been dissolved. And instead, the National Council for Regeneration, Protection and Management of River Ganga has been constituted, which is also referred as National Ganga Council. And this National Ganga Council has also been constituted under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. The purpose of this National Ganga Council is to ensure adequate flow of River Ganga so as to rejuvenate the river. Now this forms your fifth practice question. What you can do is to take a pause of 5 seconds. Now the question reads, consider the following statements about National Ganga Council. It is chaired by the Prime Minister of India. Yes, this statement is correct. It is constituted under Environment Protection Act 1986. This is also correct. Third, its primary objective is to ensure adequate flow in the River Ganga. So all these three statements given here about National Ganga Council are correct. So in this, D becomes a correct answer. So we understand that this news with respect to government report on inadequate flow in the River Ganga becomes extremely important from our UPSC examination point of view.
Hello everybody. Let us now start with the second part of today's news analysis.
Now this particular article appears in the section 2 of the Hindu newspaper on page number 10. The title of the article is Scientist Mull, Stratospheric Barrier to Curb Warming. This particular article shall be important from the perspective of GS paper 3, Environment under the subsection Environmental Conservation. Now this particular article has appeared in the newspaper because recently the scientists at the Harvard University have published a report in a journal known as the Environmental Research Letter. In this particular report, the scientists at the Harvard University have proposed a solar geoengineering project known as the Stratospheric Aerosol Injection. And this solar geoengineering project is expected to reduce the global rising temperature due to the climate change. So as part of this video analysis, we shall basically focus on three aspects. Firstly, we'll understand as to what exactly solar geoengineering and how it reduces the temperature of the Earth's surface. Secondly, we'll understand some brief details related to the stratospheric aerosol injection project as proposed by the scientists at the Harvard University. And thirdly, we'll look into certain problems with the solar geoengineering project such as the stratospheric aerosol injection. Let us start analyzing these aspects of the article one by one. Now coming to the concept of the solar geoengineering, this particular concept is based on a principle of reflecting the incoming solar radiation by the Earth's surface in order to reduce the total amount of solar radiation received by the planet, leading to its cooling. So the idea here is, if we are able to reflect the incoming solar radiation, we would be able to combat the adverse effects of the global warming. And in order to reflect the greater amount of incoming solar radiation, the concept of geoengineering emphasizes on the use of the heat reflectors such as ice, snow, and glaciers. Now these substances are used in the geoengineering because they have higher albedo. Now the albedo here refers to a property of a body to reflect the sunlight. And it is to be noted that ice, snow, and glaciers have higher albedo as compared to the other substances. It is in this particular regard, the concept of solar geoengineering uses these substances in order to reflect the incoming solar radiation. Hence, by using the heat reflectors, the solar geoengineering seeks to increase the planetary albedo. Now, the planetary albedo here refers to the total amount of sunlight which is reflected by the Earth's surface. Thus, usage of these heat reflectors act as a solar shade and cancel out the warming effect of the sun. However, one important point to be noted here is that the solar geoengineering does not seek to reduce the emission of greenhouse gases. Rather, it just seeks to reduce the incoming solar radiation by the use of heat reflectors. Another important point which I have to note here is that this particular concept of solar geoengineering is a theoretical concept. This is because the concept of geoengineering has not been implemented so far and it is still in proposal in order to reduce the adverse effects of the climate change. In this regard, let us now look at some of the methods which can be used in the solar geoengineering. Now coming to the methods used in the geoengineering, the first method involves the usage of stratospheric aerosols. This particular method is based on the principle of the volcanic eruption. Now upon the eruption of volcano, huge amount of sulfur dioxide gets emitted into the atmosphere and the emission of sulfur dioxide blocks the incoming solar radiation and leads to cooling of the Earth's surface. So this particular method of stratospheric aerosols aims to copy volcanic eruption, and this method involves usage of specialized aircraft or balloons in order to inject sulfur aerosols into the Earth's atmosphere. The reason as to why the sulfur aerosols are being used is that because these aerosols are extremely efficient in scattering and reflecting the incoming solar radiation. The second method involves the cloud modification. In this method, the seawater is being sprayed into the atmosphere and the spraying of the seawater increases the reflectivity of the clouds, leading to decrease solar radiation on the Earth's surface. The third method involves injection of iron into the oceans. Now the injection of iron into the oceans promote the growth of phytoplanktons. So the increase in the population of the phytoplanktons in the oceans lead to decrease in the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. This is because these phytoplanktons pull out the carbon dioxide during the process of photosynthesis. The fourth method involves placement of huge mirrors in the space, leading to higher reflectivity of the incoming solar radiation. The fifth method involves cool roofing technology. Now in this particular technology, white paint is being used in order to paint the roofs of the buildings, and this increases the amount of solar radiation reflected by the Earth's surface. So these are some of the methods which are being used in the geoengineering. Let us now look into the details of the stratospheric aerosol injection project as suggested by the scientists at the Harvard. The stratospheric injection project involves injection of the sulfate particles into the Earth's atmosphere, and this injection of sulfate particles is to be done by a specialized aircraft at an altitude of 20 km. It is expected that the sulfate particles would be able to act as the reflective barriers, leading to the higher reflection of the incoming solar radiation and reduced temperature on the Earth's surface. And the scientists at the Harvard believe that the implementation of this particular project would cost us around $2.25 billion every year, which is relatively inexpensive. Further, the scientists also believe that the implementation of this project would be able to reduce the increase in the Earth's temperature by almost 50%. Let us now look into the problems that would be posed by the geoengineering projects. Now, one of the most important problems associated with the geoengineering projects is that most of the geoengineering projects aims to reduce the amount of solar radiation reaching the Earth's surface. However, they do not address the root cause of the global warming. That is, they do not target the amount of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere and instead focus only on reducing the amount of incoming solar radiation. Further, the solar geoengineering projects changes the amount of solar radiation on the Earth's surface, and such changes may have adverse impact on the plant's life, since solar radiation is considered to be a critical input for the photosynthesis. Thirdly, as discussed, one of the methods of the geoengineering project is that of cloud modification. And some of the scientists have argued that the cloud modification by the geoengineering projects would have an adverse impact on the hydrological cycles. And more importantly, it is to be noted that all the models which we discussed before are hypothetical models, because of which it is extremely difficult to predict the outcome of these models. This is because all these hypothetical models are based on computer simulation. And lastly, some of the scientists have argued that the cost and maintenance of the geoengineering projects would be extremely high. So these are some of the problems which can be related to the geoengineering projects. So based on the discussion which we had so far, this would be a prelims question for the practice. Please pause this video and try to find answer to this question. We will be discussing the answer after 5 seconds. The question here is, which of the following methods can be used in the solar geoengineering? Injection of sulfate aerosols into atmosphere, injection of iron into the oceans, placing huge mirrors in the space, and cool roofing technology. Now, as we have discussed, all these 4 methods can be used in the solar geoengineering. Hence, in this regard, the correct answer to this particular question is D. So, having comprehensively covered all these aspects of the article, let us now move to the next article. This particular article appears in the section 2 of the Hindu newspaper on page number 2. The title of the article is "Recycling opens new road to stay off the plastic threat." This particular article shall be important from the perspective of GS paper 3 environment under the subsection environmental pollution and degradation. Now, this particular article mainly focuses on 3 aspects. Firstly, it explains about the plastic road technology. Secondly, it highlights the advantages of the plastic roads over that of the normal roads. And thirdly, earlier the government of India had issued guidelines on use of plastics in the construction of roads. However, these guidelines have not been followed in India. It is in this regard this article analyzes the reasons for the non-compliance of government guidelines. Hence, as part of this video analysis, let us try to understand the 3 aspects of the article one by one. Let us first understand some details related to the plastic road technology and then look at its advantages. Now, this plastic road technology has been patented by a Padma Shri Award winner known as Dr. Vasudevan, who is also referred to as the Plastic Man of India. And this particular technology involves using plastics in the road construction. Now, this particular technology is considered to be quite significant for India, mainly from 2 perspectives. Firstly, it would address the problem of the plastic disposal in India, since the plastics would be now used in the road construction. And secondly, it would also address the problem related to the bad roads. This is because the roads which are constructed by using plastics are considered to be more durable. So, since the plastic road technology addresses the problem related to the plastic disposal as well as the bad roads, this particular technology is considered to be quite significant for India. Now, coming to the technology used in the plastic roads, under this technology, the waste plastic is being added to the molten bitumen. It is to be noted that the bitumen is one of the raw material for the construction of roads. So, when the plastic is added to the molten bitumen, it creates a strong bond between the two. This is because both plastic as well as the molten bitumen are petroleum products. So, the strong bond created between the plastic and the molten bitumen leads to more durable plastic roads. Let us now look into the advantages of the plastic roads. Around 15,000 tons of plastic waste is being generated in India every day. So the plastic road technology would be able to make efficient use of this waste plastic. And at the same time, it would also address the problem related to the plastic disposal. Secondly, the plastic roads are considered to be more durable and last longer as compared to normal roads because they develop less number of potholes. This is because the plastic used in the construction of roads act as a waterproof and does not allow the water to seep down. So this ability of plastic to act as waterproof and prevent the seepage of water leads to development of less number of potholes in the plastic roads. Thirdly, the plastic roads do not crack under the extreme heat conditions. Further, this particular article highlights that earlier the government of India had issued guidelines on using plastics in the construction of roads in India. Apart from that, the Ministry of Road Transport is also encouraging the construction of national highways using the plastic road technology. However, these government guidelines have not been complied with in India. It is in this particular regard, let us try to understand as to what are the reasons for the non-compliance of government guidelines. Firstly, the road contractors in India are reluctant to use the plastics in the construction of roads. This is because these road contractors believe that they will suffer loss as the plastic roads are more durable. What this means is, once the plastic roads are constructed, the need for reconstructing the same road again and again drastically reduces, and this would in turn adversely affect the profit margin of the road contractors. Secondly, this particular article highlights that apart from the road contractors, even the urban local bodies in India are also reluctant in implementing the government guidelines. Now, this is because presently the urban local bodies receive huge grant from the states for the construction and maintenance of roads in India. And since the plastic roads require lesser maintenance, the urban local bodies feel that once the plastic roads are constructed, the amount of grants which they would reduce would drastically be cut down. It is in this regard, the urban local bodies in India are reluctant in implementing the government guidelines. Thirdly, the article highlights that presently in India, we do not have a proper mechanism to segregate or separate plastic from the other waste, because of which there is less availability of plastic to be used for the road construction. Now, these are some of the reasons for the non-compliance of the government guidelines with respect to the use of plastic in the construction of roads. Apart from this, you should also know certain basic details related to the Plastic Waste Management Rules 2016. Now, the basic details related to these rules has been provided in the PDF. Please go through the PDF in order to know the details. So, based on the discussion which we had so far, this would be a prelims question for the practice. Please pause this video and try to find answer to this question. We will be discussing the answer after 5 seconds. The question here is, consider the following statements related to the plastic road technology. The first statement is, this technology involves addition of plastic to the bitumen for the construction of roads. Now, as we have discussed, this particular statement is correct. Now, the second statement reads as, the roads constructed using this technology are more durable and develop less potholes. Now, as we have discussed, even this particular statement is also correct. Hence, the correct answer to this particular question is C. So, having analyzed all the three aspects related to this particular article, let us now move to the next article. Now, the next article appears in section 2 of the Hindu newspaper on page number 6. The title of the article is Saying Goodbye to the UN Migration Agreement. This particular article shall be important from the perspective of GS paper 2, International Relations, under the subsection Global Agreements Affecting India's Interest. Now, this particular article has appeared in the newspaper because the member countries of the United Nations are negotiating on a global agreement known as the United Nations Global Compact on Migration. However, this particular article has highlighted that Austria has decided to withdraw from this agreement. It is to be noted that earlier countries such as US, Hungary, Australia, Czech Republic had also withdrawn from this particular agreement. So, as part of this video analysis, we shall basically focus on two aspects. Firstly, we'll understand certain basic details related to the United Nations Global Compact on Migration. And secondly, we'll understand as to what is the stand of India's government on this particular agreement. The United Nations Global Compact on Migration is the first intergovernmental agreement which is currently under negotiation under the United Nations. And this particular intergovernmental agreement shall cover all the dimensions related to the international migration. Now, the importance of this particular agreement can be gauged from the fact that presently there are 250 million migrants across the world, and these migrants account for approximately 3% of the world's population. However, presently there is no comprehensive framework for protecting the rights of these migrants. So the importance of this particular agreement is that it seeks to cover all the dimensions related to the international migration in order to protect the rights of the migrants. And with respect to the genesis of this particular agreement, the origin of this particular agreement can be traced to the New York Declaration for Refugees and Migrants, which was adopted by the United Nations General Assembly in September 2016. It was under this particular declaration, the United Nations member countries agreed to develop a framework for safe, orderly and regular migration across the world. And this particular agreement is set to be finally approved at a meeting in Marrakesh, which is scheduled to be held in December 2018. Further, this particular agreement seeks to address three issues related to the international migrants. And these issues being how to protect the migrants, how to integrate the migrants into the new countries, and how to ensure the safe return of these migrants to their original home countries. And in order to address these issues, this particular international agreement is set to adopt totally 23 objectives. Some of these objectives being combating trafficking and smuggling, protection of human rights of the migrants, improved living and working condition of the migrants, and to prevent the exploitation of the migrants and their families. Further, one of the most important aspects related to this particular agreement is that this agreement shall be a non-binding agreement, which means that even if this particular agreement is approved, the provisions of this agreement would be non-binding on the member countries. So these are some of the aspects which one should know with respect to this particular agreement. Let us now try to understand as to why has Austria decided to withdraw from this agreement. Further, let's also discuss as to what is India's response to this particular international agreement. Now, the Austrian government has mainly two concerns with respect to this particular agreement. Firstly, the Austrian government believes that this particular agreement would encourage the international migration, and this would go against its domestic policy to deal with the migrants. And secondly, the Austrian government believes that this particular international agreement does not differentiate between the legal migrants and the asylum seekers. So the Austrian government is apprehensive of the fact that since there is no clear-cut differentiation between the legal migrants and the asylum seekers under this agreement, it would be forced to recognize the asylum seekers. It is in this regard the Austrian government has decided to withdraw from the agreement. Let us now look at as to what is India's response to this agreement. India has welcomed the Global Compact Migration with open arms. However, it has asked United Nations Agency to make a clear distinction between the illegal and legal migrants. This is because India believes that the illegal migrants cannot be treated at par with the legal migrants. So based on the discussion which we had so far, this would be a prelims question for the practice. Please pause this video and try to find answer to this question. We will be discussing answer after 5 seconds. Now this is a very simple question which reads as, what does the New York Declaration adopted by the United Nations General Assembly in 2016 deal with? And as discussed, the correct answer to this particular question is B, that is protection of the rights of the migrants. So having analyzed all the aspects related to this particular article, let us now move to the next article. Now the next article appears in section 1 of the Hindu newspaper on page number 15. The title of the article is Demystifying Signs, What Are Hunter Viruses? This particular article shall be important from the perspective of prelims under the subsection General Science. This particular article discusses about various aspects related to the Hunter viruses. So as part of this video analysis, let us understand some brief details related to the Hunter virus. Now the Hunter virus is a single stranded RNA virus which can cause severe lung infection known as Hunter virus pulmonary syndrome. And this particular infection can prove fatal in some of the cases. Further, the symptoms of this particular infection include fatigue, fever, and muscle aches. And with respect to transmission of this virus, the rodents are considered to be main reservoirs of this virus. And the virus gets transmitted through The body fluids excreted by the rodent, such as the saliva, urine, etc. Further, you need to note that the human-to-human transmission of this particular virus normally does not take place. And presently, there is no treatment available for the treatment of this infection. Lastly, this particular article highlights that as the global temperature increases due to climate change, there is a probability of increase in the chances of the infection caused by the virus. Now, these are some of the aspects which one should know with respect to the Hanta virus. So, based on the discussion which we had so far, this would be a prelims question for the practice. Please pause this video and try to solve the question. We will be discussing the answer after 5 seconds. The question here is, consider the following statements related to the Hanta virus. The first statement is, it causes severe infection in the kidneys, which can prove fatal in some cases. Now, this particular statement is wrong because, as we have discussed, it causes infection in the lungs and not kidneys. The second statement reads as, it gets transmitted from the infected rodents as well as humans. Now, even this particular statement is wrong because, as we have discussed, this particular virus does not get transmitted from the infected humans. Hence, the correct answer to this particular question is D, that is neither one nor two. With this, let us now move to the next article. Now, the next article appears in section 1 of the Hindu newspaper on page number 8. Now, this particular article is in the form of an image titled as Making a Splash. This particular article shall be important from the perspective of prelims under the subsection The Cultural History of India. This particular article discusses about Kambala, which is a form of buffalo race. Hence, as part of this video analysis, let us try to understand some brief details related to the Kambala buffalo race. The Kambala buffalo race is a cultural tradition which is under practice in the coastal Karnataka, particularly in districts of Udupi and Dakshin Kannada. And this particular buffalo race usually lasts from the month of November to that of March. And this buffalo race has unique cultural tradition because it is believed that it has originated approximately around 800 years back. And this buffalo race is dedicated to Lord Manjunatha, who is considered to be incarnation of Lord Shiva. And this buffalo race is carried out in order to please the gods for a good harvest. Further, the Kambala buffalo race had turned controversial in the previous year. This was because the Supreme Court of India had put a ban on Jallikattu, a bull taming sport in Tamil Nadu, subsequent to which the Karnataka High Court also banned the Kambala race under the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, subsequent to which the Karnataka Legislative Assembly passed the bill in order to exempt the Kambala race from the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. Now, these are some of the aspects which one should know with respect to the Kambala buffalo race.
With this, we have come to end of today's discussion. Now, let us look at the question for the day.